Antonium to the end? Because it's a lot bigger.
Commissioner Scott? Commissioner Scott, present? Did you ask? Present?
Loretta Scott, present.
Commissioner Booth?
George Booth, present.
David Kilgore, present.
Your mic on?
Kevin Chernus, present.
And Chairman Booth, Chairman Middleman is via Zoom, but Commissioner Chernus will be chairing the meeting.
I think it's just a suggestion.
They had requested to deviate to agenda item number four, to start with agenda item number four. You can deviate to agenda
item number four. I'm sorry, my mic was off. Does anybody have a problem with moving item number two down or starting with number four? Or is anyone?
Is that a motion, sir?
It can be done with a consensus of the board.
I'll call for the vote. Vote for the consensus. I'll call for vote.
Okay.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Nay.
Barry, which way did you go? It was to move number. It was to move and number two down. Go start with number four. The tree ordinance.
I'd say yay.
Okay. Pass. He said yay. Okay. There's a public hearing on application submitted by Neva Morris on behalf of Crown Castle USA, Northwest Military, Castle Hills, Texas. Oh, I'm sorry, CB5778 PA899A. ABS 260 CHCB 220 at 2279 Northwest Military Highway, Castle Hills, Texas, for the proposed removal of one oak tree for the construction of new commercial structure, which will increase connectivity. Do we have anybody here to talk on behalf?
The public hearing opens at 7:03.
Go ahead.
Good evening, I'm Ovea Morris. I'm here on behalf of Crown Castle, Vapor Edge, and CPS Energy. Next slide. So as you mentioned before, we're requesting to remove one live oak tree on property we classified as 2002 Lock Hill Selma Road here in Castle Hills. Next slide. You can keep clicking and it'll pop up some stuff. The reason being is that we have a new customer being added to our compound, Vapor Edge. With Vapor Edge, it's going to help a lot of the latency issues in the community. You may notice that there's a lot of demand, especially wireless right now. So with Vapor Edge being implemented in this area, you won't have, you know, your phone buffering for various little things. So with so much demand in this area, we're adding Vapor Edge so it can house a lot of the data. You can keep going on the PowerPoint. With that being said, by 2022, we should have about 29 billion devices recorded. 80% or more of your calls for 911 are done on a wireless cell phone. And then 96% of Americans own a cell phone. So with that being said, we are having that new data housing there. You can do next slide if you want. Yeah, it's a lot. Yeah. Thank you, Wayne. Yeah. So with that being said, it's on property 2002 Lock Hill Summer Road. The property owner here is CPS Energy, and we, the tower owner, Crown Castle, is implementing this new customer Vapor Edge. With that being said, Vapor Edge does require electricity. So we are implementing an electrical easement about 20 feet wide and then 28 feet wide about where the tree is, because we are adding a new riser pole and then removing an existing and adding a new one. Next slide. This whole property has various trees that are going to remain. It's just the one that's being removed. Next slide. So with this proposed easement, there is going to be trenching. So within that easement, like I said, we're adding that new riser pole, removing the old one, adding the new one to meet the demand for vapor and add electricity housing for vapor. And next slide. So we actually did conduct our arborist report. We had a certified arborist go out there just to see if we could possibly avoid removing the tree. We had Mr. Herrera go out there and identify the tree as live oak, 63 inches in diameter breast height, and a canopy drip line of 41 feet. With the easement, we did tell him that we have construction going 4 feet down with the trenching. And unfortunately, that's going to get into the critical root zone of the tree and potentially kill the tree. If we did not remove the tree, it would cause issues with the electrical work being done there. In the future, we could have an outage, which no one really wants. So with that being said, the ultimate conclusion here was to remove the tree because it would die with construction. Next slide. And any questions as far as that goes?
What's the public hearing? So, but I do have questions. I have a question. I read your arborist report. There was nothing in here about digging a trench and sweeping around the tree. That is a very valid way to lay line when you have a tree of this magnitude. Even the arborist report suggests that a holistic approach would be better than to remove a heritage oak. So, when your arborist is even saying that, if the overall consensus is to remove the live oak, that he says that trees should be replaced. I don't see anywhere that you've suggested even replacing the inches of tree and putting new tree in lieu of this. But even so, there are ways to keep this heritage oak and still trench with the process of sweeping around. It's not a straight line. It's more expensive on your part. But I'm curious as to why that's not something that you considered, or did you consider it? Because it looks like here that he stated a metal lining can be placed parallel with the walls of the ditch to direct the tree into deeper soil. So I'm having issue that we're going to take the tree out because it's the fastest and easiest way for y'all, but not necessarily the best for the tree, the property, or the overall aesthetic of the city.
Yeah, so we don't really have a problem with, of course, I wouldn't want to remove the tree either. There's always the possibility of having other trees added in the area, but because there is that new riser pole going up, if that tree were to stay, it would get in the way of the lines. The other thing too is with the construction, we're going to have to get into that critical root zone. So we are going to damage the tree regardless with that trenching. I'm not a construction expert, so I'm not sure what else we consider, but with the metal lining, it still would impact the root system of the tree.
It could impact the root system, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to kill the tree. If you air spade around the root system, check and see what's there, and then sweep around the tree itself as you lay the electrical conduit, that's always an option when installing electrical underground. So, and then clean up the tree itself, bring it up to maybe 14 foot height, and do everything you can to keep it as a heritage oak here in Castle Hills. I did not see that illustration with the upper poles anywhere except in your presentation. It was not in my packet that I saw. Gentlemen, did you see the illustration with the poles above? I didn't see that until tonight. So there was no indication that there were poles or lines going through where the tree currently is sitting.
Okay, my name is Tony Clay. I'm a construction manager with Crown Castle. And I'm in partner with the existing CM that's in conjunction with this project. And through design, we did explore boring underneath to avoid any disturbance for the tree. And I've worked in San Antonio, and I understand a lot of the tree arborists and for the past 30 years. So if we had the bore, we would have to, we wouldn't be able to meet the proper depth that's required to go under the tree.
No, I'm not talking about going under the tree, sir. Sweeping around the tree.
That's where our easement is located at. And that's where we're being bound to stay within those parameters. We cannot go outside those parameters in regards to our solidified easement that we currently have. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to stay within. Right now we have a smaller easement along the border, but it's filled up with telco and fiber. And we have to have a separation according to CPS requirements. We have to have a separation. And they also have to have exposure of a conduit to where they can inspect it. In order to make their inspections, we would have to excavate. Now we did explore the option of trimming the tree and going ahead and trenching, mm-hmm. but it would take 40% of your root system out. We're fine if it's okay to do that, but we don't want to be responsible for killing the tree after the fact. We cannot guarantee that the tree will live. It also bears, if we do trench it, it bears a safety issue in regards to any storms, high winds, et cetera. This may kill our project if we cannot remove the tree. We are willing to replant other trees. We'll do 3-4 and take care of them as a goal if it's possible. But if we do trench it, I feel it is unsafe. To leave the tree, it'll deroot the system, basically. And their trenching requires us to be about 48 inches into the ground, and then we pour concrete. It's a flowable fill that they require us to put on top of it. So there's not a lot of growth that the tree roots can repath themselves. They'll be hitting a wall. So I'm hoping I'm explaining it correctly to you.
Are you unable to relocate the easement?
Excuse me?
Are you able to relocate the easement? Move it, go out?
Currently, with the CPS property that's there, that easement that they have right now kind of locks us in because they have an in and an out for all the crane and truck activity. And if you could probably pull up the picture of the front of it, but that's main access there. And we're kind of locked in to that position. We can go back to CPS and ask for it to be moved over slightly, but then we incur, I think we even did that, but we have too many 90s. If you exceed over 40 or 490s, then it's gonna be a little bit more difficult for them to pull the wire. So that's to kind of go around it, because the pole placements that they're showing there is in line with, that one there. So that driveway right there is their in and out for their crane activity, power distribution plant that's existing there. That's one of their main drives that they utilize to exit the property. And they don't have proper room to turn around and everything in there. So they make a loop. Through the curved driveway, they make a loop, come around, and then they come out that end. So to service our tower as well, we utilize that area for crane activity. If we are forced to move our transformer closer to the driveway, That will interrupt our crane activity for future maintenance. That's why we're trying to keep it away from the edge of the driveway where those red lines are, to where we can keep our crane activity, you know, with the outriggers and everything, we need 60 feet.
Are the new riser poles on this illustration the actual cell tower that's going to be put in itself?
No, ma'am. That's just that riser pole right there is just a utility pole. And our cell tower for the facility that's going to be installed is a building. It's a two-story hub that we're calling that we chose as Castle Hills to be the home for that hub. And it will also put you on the map. There's only two being entered in and around San Antonio. We've done one over on Highway 90 and 410, and we've already did our power work. We did everything. We need one more hub. That hub is here in Castle Hills. So that's in future permitting process funds for that's going to bring up the, we're going to be needing, everybody's going to want to connect to this hub. So you're going to be able to, you know, the permits, the fees and everything should be good for the city.
Well, let me clarify, this hub is a building or a cell tower or
no,
both?
No, our cell tower currently exists.
You okay.
Can kind of see it in the back?
In the background, that's our cell tower.
That's a cell tower. So what is going to be constructed on this pad site?
It's going to be a two-story shelter.
It's more of a one-story unmanned building that kind of houses data. And yeah. On top, it has a stealth HVAC system, so you don't hear anything and it doesn't get overheated. Like I mentioned, it's basically it's for all the connectivity in this area. Like I said, for latency issues in general, if you are like on your phone and you can't connect with your grandchild, it's because of that. There's just so much demand on this network that that's supposed to house that, so it helps with the connectivity here. This is being done nationwide for big cities where, you know, there's just so much demand and we can't, you know.
How big is this this tree that's being removed? What's the caliber? In inches.
Sorry.
The caliper is approximately 30 inches.
30 inches. Would you be willing to plant the equivalent of 30 inches of caliper and new trees?
Excuse me, Barry, I think he misspoke. The arborist report says that it's 63 inches in diameter at breast height. Is it a 63-inch diameter tree or a 30-inch diameter tree, sir?
Yeah, we'll have to go to the arborist. I'm probably speaking out of turn. I don't know the project that I just got off.
Barry, the tree is 63 inches.
Well, in the city of San Antonio, there'd be a much larger penalty for removal of a heritage tree. I think it would either be 2-1 or 3-1. But if it's 60 or 30, my question is will they plant new trees with the same equivalency of that particular tree size in that center section where the other trees are?
What would be the equivalence? I'm not sure. Would it be
1-1? If it's a 60-inch tree, you'd have to plant 6 12-inch trees six-inch trees. Is that right? Is that the right math? Thank you.
So it's approximate, Barry. The total inches of trees total would have to equal 63 inches. It'd have to equal the tree that you're taking out. So whether you put in 10 six-inch trees and 1 3-inch tree or however, but there would need to be tree replacement. And it looks like there are quite a bit of trees along the front of that property, not in this specific parcel, but there are other trees there. That's typically required by the city of San Antonio. Castle Hills, usually it's offered to us as something when you're going to remove a tree of this size that you would replace the inches of the tree in new tree.
How wide is the trench you're proposing to dig?
The width of the trench is normally about 24 inches wide.
It looks like a really wide easement that you just have to fit 24 inches of trench into. So Is there another area within your easement that you could place this trench?
There's also fiber as a separation. So it's also going to include fiber. So you'll have your 24 inches and then 5 foot separation, you'll have another 24 inches. So it's a span of about 9 feet.
So theoretically, you could put one of your 24-inch trenches down one side of your easement and one of your 24-inch trenches down the other side of your easement and get around the tree altogether.
Again, our easement stops at the branch area, the shadow area of the tree. We would have to go better under the shadow area, the overbranching. So we don't have an easement up against the driveway there to give us that proper separation. And we would, we can always hug it, but again, we're still tearing into the easement.
But at the drip line, you're tearing into a different level of root system than you are up closer to the trunk. And your arborist is really feels it's really important to save this tree, and he says it's a, you know, it's a healthy, excellent specimen. It looks like the easy route definitely is to go straight down the center of your easement and axe the tree. But I think there are alternatives that haven't been explored yet.
I mean, we can, like I said, we can always replant. I don't have it like here, I have it over there, but the arborist did say that there are different, he does recommend, I think about 4 different trees or 3 different trees of varying sizes to replant in order to, you know, make up for removing the tree. So that is a possibility.
Right, but a 63-inch tree is a whole different story than, you know, 63 one-inch trees. You know, if I'm personally not as worried about equivalence as equalcy. So that if you're taking out a 63-inch tree, put back in a 63-inch tree or move the 63-inch tree that you've got. A whole bunch of little trees are not as important to me as one established heritage tree.
Well, we'd have a minimum size. I don't think you can plant a 1-inch, but there may be, like we did on a previous site, a minimum of 6-inch trees. And so that would be 10 new 6-inch trees, and maybe a 3-inch tree would be the equivalency. Did the arborist indicate just how far away from the tree we would be able to actually protect, get confidence that we'd have protection for the tree?
Sir, if you could please repeat.
Did the arborist suggest just how far out from the base of the tree we could safely trench with a much better odds of preserving the tree? What was, in other words, how far from the tree can he go where he has confidence? Because I know that if you can preserve, let's say it's a 20-inch tree, well, the root protection zone might be 20 feet of radius. And if that were the case, then I think if you preserve 75% of it with pervious cover like grass, you can take 25% out. So you'd still have the equivalency of the root protection zone centered on the tree. But that's something would have to be something that had to be discussed, you know, with an arborist. But it seems like there ought to be some form of concession.
Mr. Middleman, this is Ms. Scott. Here in the arborist report, it does say that he, the arborist, Mr. Herrera, would highly recommend an air spade excavation to take place to expose the anchoring roots of this tree to see if it could potentially be pruned below grade. That would help implicate a root protection plan to move forward with the project, if need be, in protecting and keeping the tree. The arborist himself also states that he would highly recommend a holistic route over removing a tree this mature and established. He goes on to say various options, but first, before they could figure out exactly how much root damage would occur, an air spading would need to be done and another arborist report of what's found once they see what the roots are, once the air spade takes that dirt away from the base of the tree, seems to indicate that he would be able to give a better idea of what roots exactly would be in peril here.
Okay, and then if we're held to the air spading, now if you can look at that, it looks like a light color. It says an existing underground three-phase power. That's also the reason that we're pointing out that we have to keep a separation. That conduit, it's several conduits feeding the power plant for CPS, and that is built in a vault. It's a four-foot wide concrete vault. I don't know how deep it is, but we have to have the separation to that. That's what's also pushing us towards the base of the tree. If we do air spading, it's going to probably be about maybe within the first 2 foot of the tree base. So it's going to be very close to the main root system. Just looking at this picture right here on the left shows us the route for the underground, and it's going to be very, very close to the base of the tree. So, if we're held to the air spading, it's still... I'm just concerned about stability of the tree while people are working. Number one, we would need a tree permit to do the trimming to work under the tree because the tree branches are already cut to the ground. And then they would have to get access to the tree and probably safely guide for the tree or something, support the tree to where, in case there's high winds or something, the people are safe working there nearby.
I think at this point, we might need to close the public hearing and then get into the discussion.
Just one other question real quick. Your easement, something you said, is at the right at the tree line? It's not over closer to the driveway?
Yes, sir. Our easement is that yellow highlight. That's our easement for our utilities and access.
Is there anyone?
Yeah. Has anybody else signed up to speak on the tree warrants?
There is no, it's public hearing, sir. So we don't have citizens signed up to speak this evening.
Does anybody else want to speak on it?
Is that existing vault you're referring to under the root protection zone, under the roots?
Barry, we're going to close the public hearing part and then we'll go to discussion.
Okay.
We're going to close the public hearing at 7:27. We thank you and go to committee's discussion.
Agenda item number 5, discussion possible action on the application submitted by Crown Castle USA Inc. CB 5778 P-99A ABS 260 CHCB 220 2279 Northwest Military Highway, Castle Hills, Texas, for the proposed removal of one oak tree for the construction of a new commercial structure, which will be used for connectivity. If we get a motion and a second for discussion and possible action.
Motion.
So moved.
David, you have a second?
I'll second.
Hi, George. We're open for discussion.
Barry, Mr. Middleman, we're back open for discussion. Did you have a question?
Well, you had mentioned we couldn't get too close to an existing vault that was which was encased in concrete. Where is that existing vault in relation to the tree? Is it under the roots?
It's the baby blue highlight. I think that's the color. It's the baby blue dotted line on the left-hand side of the picture that is showing on the screen now.
Mary, it's actually right next to the easement.
I see it.
Does that existing vault encroach or impede your easement in any way? Excuse me? Does that existing vault that we're discussing right now, does that encroach on or impede your use of your easement in any way?
It impedes it gives us a limit, and that is our border. We cannot cross it. They don't allow anything real close to it. We have to have a separation. And as far as I know right now, we have to stay 2 to 3 feet away from that vault.
But does that 2 to 3 feet hit the edge of your easement, or does that encroach into your easement?
That hits the edge of the easement.
That's the edge, okay. So you can run right up against the edge of your easement?
Yes.
Okay, on both sides?
On both sides, yeah. The only thing is, over to the right of the picture, along the property line, there's an alley right there. So we have several existing fiber lines running through there that we have to keep away from.
Pardon me. Yeah. Go ahead.
No, I just want to let you know that the right side, if anybody's thinking that you can put it on the right side up against our property line, we have approximately about 4 existing conduits there that are blocking our path, and we wouldn't get any type of separation to the existing.
But those, talking about the data lines on the right-hand side, those are again outside your easement, and you can work all the way to the edge of your easement?
Those are inside the easement.
So someone else is already in your easement?
No, sir. That's our conduit for existing carriers.
Gotcha.
That are there. Right, correct.
Okay, I'm going to clarify one more time. This conduit, this electrical lines that you want to put in are for the building that's going on the site?
Yes, ma'am.
But we don't have design of that building, nothing to see. Is the building manned? Is someone in it?
It's unmanned. It's basically a one-story building. I have a picture on my computer, but the top part is a stealth HVAC system in order to maintain the heat. You could think of it like a computer, like a bunch of computers in one room. That houses all that data. And so on top of that is like an HVAC system in order for it to not overheat. And then the stealth thing keeps it quiet. I don't know if you would want to see a picture of it.
Marita, I believe Mr. Zamarone, the structure will have to come back to ARC. I think that's the next after the tree removal structure.
Typically, I'm used to seeing it all. I'm used to seeing what the structure is going to look like and where the power is going and everything before we're asked to start removing trees. Usually we see what's going on as a whole. That's why I'm asking, what does this building look like on this pad site and what is it exactly used for? That wasn't very clear. I had to Google who these companies were. At first, I saw Vape.io, and until I Googled them, I thought you were putting a vape shop in. I didn't know what you were doing. You were not clear in the documentation as to exactly what this building was going to be. I had to Google Vape.io to figure out they were a cell phone carrier and a communications and IA company. So excuse me if I'm just trying to get clarification of information on exactly what this building that you're going to put in, that you're going to construct, does, and if it's going to be operational on a daily basis, if it's going to be manned.
And I may be incorrect, but from what I remember is this is a CPS property, and we are not required to pull any building permits for the building itself that's going on the property.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore, it probably the reason why you don't have that movement because there was no zoning requirements required. So that's probably why we didn't share that with you, but we're willing to.
Okay. Mr. Zamarone.
Good evening.
Yes, sir.
To clear that up a little bit, generally speaking, you're absolutely right that there is at least some representation of what's going to go on a particular lot or project. In this particular case, the gentleman's correct that I have to actually do some research to figure out exactly where the exempt status is on an infrastructure site that is exempted, tax exempted, and if that exempts them from any type of ARC representation on any particular structure that may require review from the ARC. It's not to even determine whether a structure would be required if it was to exist on something other than an exempt lot. Having said that, the reason that this body has seen very simple site representation, site footprint representations of other projects, it's because they're completely private projects occurring on private land, which is not the case here. So my thinking for my office was, let's get the first hurdle out of the way of tree. and we can look at a, then I can take a look at a footprint to determine what's going to happen. I don't need engineering plans at this point. Is there going to be another arc hearing for the actual structure itself? I would have made the determination and then asked you all to convene. If that was the case, or find out exactly how the exempt status is by what legal mechanism from Mr. Schnall, and not move forward with an ARC review. So there was a lot of more questions. This was the first hurdle, which is very, it's not analogous to the other cases that this body has heard in the recent past.
Pardon my ignorance, but who is the speaker?
My name is Louis Zamora. I'm the assistant to the city manager.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so my question is, this is a tax exempt property because it's owned by the city of San Antonio and CPS?
CPS.
That's it's owned by that's CPS, correct. Not, okay, it's owned by CPS, so it's a tax exempt property.
Possibly.
Possibly.
Because this is a private venture.
Okay.
So I don't know if there's a partnership or agreement with CPS that allows them to exist. My first step in research would have been a question of how did that tower come to exist on that property, under what auspice, and if it was permitted or if it fell under an exempt umbrella, and then kind of duplicate that same process if this was the case.
Thank you, because I had just as many questions, so, and I wasn't sure where to find the answers to that. But
this is the first baby step on, in this process, to be honest.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Zimmer.
We have any other discussions?
No.
No more.
I could please get clarification on the motion, whether it is to approve or.
Before we move, I do have one more question. If we were to approve replacement trees, how long would you guarantee to us that those trees would be taken care of so that they establish themselves and flourish?
Okay, so we're not in the practice of maintaining that, but we can give, we can put a contract in with a local landscaper, and I'm sure that the good city of Castle Hills has recommendation for making sure that the trees are taken care of. I'm thinking 3 months. But if you tell me more, then you can let us know that.
I was kind of thinking in period of years, because it's going to take a while for those things to establish themselves if you plant new.
Yeah, so I live here locally. I work closely with CPS operatives, and we do have a vegetation crew that maintains the properties that we have, and I can reach out to them. Of course, something like this would require a landscape plan, and we'll have to get it approved by you guys, and we'd take it from there.
Thank you.
Okay. I believe when Rapid Wash put in the trees on their property, it was a year guarantee.
Okay.
Do we have any motions?
I move to decline their application.
We have a second. A second. Motion denied.
What? Motion will die due to lack of a second.
Yes. Sorry.
May I make another motion?
Go ahead, Barry.
Go ahead.
I'd like to make a motion that there be a thorough investigation and the various options available in preserving this tree with a registered arborist, and as a fallback, if that tree is obstructing this very important electrical system, that the equivalent of the 63 inches or whatever the actual dimensions of the tree are will be replaced with the equivalency with trees starting at a minimum of six, oak trees starting with a minimum of 6 inches to replant to replace this one if it has to be removed. That's a long, I know, a long motion.
Did you catch that, Woody? We have a second.
I'm going to second it so we can open it for discussion and clarify exactly what Mr. Middleman said. So Ms. Scott seconds it for discussion so we can clarify exactly what Mr. Middleman asked for them to do.
I believe he asked that we research all options in order to preserve the tree. If it's not feasible to preserve the tree, that they be replaced with a minimum of six inch oak trees.
Yeah.
Is that correct, sir?
With the same number of oak trees as the equivalency in the size of this tree.
Equivalent in size of the diameter of the tree.
Yes, if it's a 63 inch tree or whatever the caliper inches of the tree is, or the diameter of the tree is, that they plant the equivalent in inches with trees that would be a minimum of 6 inches in live oak. Is that clear?
If we approve that, Mr. Middleman, would that be sending it to council with those
additions
to them, or would this come back to see us again here in ARC? It would come back to ARC.
I think so.
So
do you have to discuss the options?
We have a motion and a second. We have an open for discussion.
Mr. Middleman, I've got a question. This is David Kilgore. Do you mind an amendment to your motion?
Not at all.
The presenters had discussed a landscape plan. If they do choose to go the route of replacement trees, I'd like to amend Mr. Middleman's motion to require that the landscape plan be presented before the agreement to remove the tree is granted.
I'll second that motion, or that amendment to the motion.
So you would vote on the amendment.
Okay. All in favor of the motion as presented, say aye.
To vote on the amendment.
Oh, I'm sorry. As motion with the amendment, correct?
Yes.
The amendment to the motion, correct? The
amendment to the motion.
Aye.
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 Aye. It's consensus. Ayes have it.
How to vote on the original motion.
Okay.
The Barry vote.
Okay, that was a voting on the amendment. So I apologize. Okay, vote on the original amendment by Barry about
the motion as amended.
With amendment. Do I have any ayes?
Yep. Aye.
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 Okay. Barry?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Yeah.
There 4 ayes. Any nays?
No.
No. 1 nay. Motion passes. Okay. Okay. Do we go back up to, I'm going to ask, do we go back to 2 or do we go down to 6? Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we go back up? We'll just do what?
I'd recommend we proceed to 6 and 7.
Okay, we're going to public hearing and application. Application by Michael Legg for CB 577 Block Knoll, Lot 7, CHCB 220, Castle Hills, Commercial UT, 2269 Northwest Military Highway, Castle Hills, for proposed exterior renovation of exterior commercial construction. Open for public. Go ahead.
At 7:44 p.m.
7:44 p.m., I apologize.
Good evening. We basically remodeling.
Your name, sir?
Michael Legg from Legg Architecture LLC. We're remodeling the existing Jack in the Box. The site itself is virtually unchanged, other than adding in additional landscape items. The interior plan is, there's very little changes, other than two little walls that one's reduced and the other is increased. And then the rest is rebranding. And then we also improve the fire exits. But I think the big change is really to do with the aesthetics of the Jack in the Box. And that has a wraparound awning with those big towers, which we removed, and then redesigned it so that it's in keeping with the prototype of a golden chick. And the colors are also in keeping with, you know, what the branding is.
Okay.
Yeah. That's
okay. Yeah. Right. That we're, that's the end of the public hearing. Open up for discussions.
I would like to make
746. I'm sorry.
I'd like to make a comment, if I may. I think that you've done a very good job of restoring this building under the branding of your golden chick, and the issue really to us specifically was that you were mandated to go before the Architectural Review Board for approval of the exterior elevation of the building. That's not to say we don't agree that we like it or we don't like it. It's just that the procedure was that you went and got a building permit prematurely before you got before you got the approval of the Architectural Review Committee on the exterior, with us having the understanding that you were not doing any remodeling on the outside of the building, and that's where there was the problem. My only concern is that you're not in any way affecting this, the parapet heights of the existing building that would screen all rooftop equipment.
Yeah, no, we aren't. It's the parapet heights are retained at the exact same height.
Can you speak up?
Can I make a motion quickly to open item number 5, the discussion and possible action application submitted by Olivia Morris on behalf of I'd like to make a motion to open number 7, discussion and possible action on an application submitted by Michael Legg for CB 5778 Block Knoll, Lot 7, CHCB 220, Castle Hills Commercial UT, 2269 Northwest Military Highway, Castle Hills, for the proposed exterior renovation of an existing commercial structure.
Seconded.
So you didn't, I apologize, I was listening to you. You are covering it, you're keeping the same facade height, so you're covering all the equipment that's on the roof.
Yes.
So the aesthetics is gonna stay basically the same, just the outside look is just changing the color and the design.
Yes, correct. Yeah, and I apologize about the process in terms of it not going through the ARC process. I just submitted it to the city thinking that if there was a need for it, because it was a remodel, that they would have, you know, made us aware, which did eventually happen.
I think we've covered that with Mr. Zamarone and myself and the applicant about the process. So again, that's why we're here tonight.
Okay. Any other?
I have a question. You're putting in a new sign, I think, on the Northwest Military side of the property, and where the existing sign is?
It'll just be refaced.
Replacing with a Refaced. Oh, excuse me. Okay, thank you.
So there is no new signage, because I couldn't find any signage. You're not putting any tall signage or anything, just refacing the building.
Well, what the sign that's there will be refaced with the golden check and not the Jack in the Box sign.
Just replacing the existing signage with your signage. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, that's kind of a low sign up close to Northwest Military. And from what I hear, you're just going to put the your logos on the existing sign. You're not going to change the sign in any other way.
Yeah, and that, from my understanding, is by separate application as well.
Perfect. Yeah. Next question, any impact to the trees or other established vegetation on the property?
No. You know, we've taken down the fence that's on the northern side. It was like a screen fence, and it tends to hide the building. And the intent is to have some spotlights at the base of those trees on the drive-through side to light up the trees at night.
Okay, thank you.
Are you using the same, was there an existing dumpster enclosure for the Jack in the Box, and are you using the same enclosure or creating a new one?
No, we're using the existing dumpster. It would just be repainted.
Okay.
Close the discussion.
What size was the tree? I'm sorry.
The tree.
The tree says you're going to remove a tree.
No, we're not removing any trees.
Oh.
No.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept Golden Chick's proposed exterior renovation and of the existing commercial structure.
I have a second.
Second.
Hi, David. All in favor, say aye.
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 Unanimously? Okay.
This will be at City Council on September 14th.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That closes a discussion on the Golden Chick. Okay, we're going to be a public hearing on an application submitted by Mark Mikowski for the Antonia Preparation High School, CB 500 5A, Block 8, Lot 1, 6425 West Avenue, Castle Hills, Texas. Proposed construction and new indoor activities at 7:52 p.m. Open for public discussion.
My name is Charles Moy, and I'm with Markowski and Associates. Mark Markowski was going to attend this meeting, but he was in close contact with somebody who tested positive for COVID. So I spoke to Lewis about coming in, taking this meeting, and Lewis had no problem with me coming in since I do work with Mark in the office. We were hired by Antonian High School to develop a plan for a new 24,500 square foot, what they're calling an indoor activity center. The center is gonna have multiple basketball courts, and then also have that can be reconfigured to have as many as four volleyball games at a time. Also in the building will be girls locker rooms and a weight room for both the boys and the girls to use for the sports. The project and the location is going to be on a site where the existing tennis courts were, because the new tennis courts were built down by the existing football fields about 8 years ago. The site currently is on the lower or mid-level of the site. You will not be able to see the new building from West Avenue because the existing main building will block the view. You might catch a glimpse of it if you're heading north on West Avenue, right between the time you get to just past the church there, and before you reach the campus there itself, there might be a glimpse by the softball field. The building itself is going to be approximately 200 foot long by 122 foot wide. The highest point of the of the ridge is going to be about 38 feet above the ground. The building will be sprinkled. There's also some rooftop equipment, which we do plan to parapet to try and hide as much of it as possible. But again, because of the location of the building, the only ones are going to be able to see any of the rooftop unit will be the main building from the windows of the classrooms in the main building. The exterior of the building is going to be all metal. It's a pre-engineered metal building framing, and we're going to in the package there's a three color scheme. There's a beige color that's probably 90% of the building, with some of the little bit of red because that's the color Antonian's team colors, and a gray roof. The gray roof is matching the color of the existing buildings that are, there's two buildings down there on the same level that have metal roofs on them, and we're trying to match those colors so it ties together. We're also going to use, there's existing dumpsters out there already that's on campus, that's, so we're not going to add any new dumpsters. The building itself is going to be used during the day for the schools, for the students, so we're not adding additional parking, because at the time that it's being utilized by the students, there's parking there for the students. After school and on the weekends, when there's students have left the campus, that the parking's going to be available for somebody wants to come in and attend any event that may be there. There's no fixed seating in the building. It's all going to be rolled bleachers that can be reconfigured based on the event that's happening in there. And per the International Building Code, we can only base the fact that the square footage on the International Building Code, we can only get this 325 occupants at any one time based on the square footage of the building, since there's not fixed seating. And I think that's what I have to say right now.
We're going to close the public hearing at 7:56 p.m. Discussion for the possibility of action on the application submitted by Mark Murkowski for the Antonian Preparation High School, CB 500-5A, Block 8, Lot 1, 6425 West Avenue, Castle Hills, Texas, for proposed construction of a new indoor activity center. Discussion?
Was that a motion?
The agenda item.
Okay.
So now we need a motion.
I will move for discussion and possible action.
I'll second.
I just want to verify. You said there is no seeing this from the front, and the air conditioning equipment, you said you're going to be roof mounting, but you are going to, it's only going to be seen to the interior of the area, that the building front.
That's correct. Building? You might catch a glimpse of the building from West Avenue if you're heading north on West Avenue from Loop 410. There's a church there, and you got I guess it's Texas A&M's facility. Then you got the church, and in between that church and the main building, the school building itself, there's a little view there, but there's also heavily tree on West Avenue. So you might catch a glimpse of the building as you're heading north. Coming south, you'll never be able to see the building because the main building is going to block the view.
Okay. And the drainage and landscaping, you're not changing any of the drainage going over the existing tennis courts, or y'all?
No, we're actually going to rip up the tennis court for the new foundation. And so the, if you want to call it the impervious coverage is not changing. So the tennis court concrete is going to be torn up, and the building foundation is going to be put in that area. So we're not increasing any runoff from the, because it was already concrete. Now we're going to put concrete back, just the building foundation with the building on top of it. Your question about the rooftop units, yes, they will only be seen from the main building.
Is there going to be any change to the exterior lighting around that area?
We're putting a few security lights around the, on the perimeter of the building itself. I think there's a picture in the package of it. They do shine down. They're not going to light the sky. They're not, you know, they're basically wall packs.
Okay. We've talked about viewing the new facility from West Avenue. What about, is it going to be seen from any homes in the area?
No.
No.
The homes are, there's a two-story building already down there. That's a CMU block. And this building is going to be put next to the two-story building. So I think, plus the distance from this new building, you have to pass by. There's the distance, there's a swimming pool. These buildings, there's a swimming pool, then there's the baseball field before you actually get to the residential street, which I can't think of the name of it off the top of my head.
Okay.
Mr. Turnus, on your question on the drainage, Mr. Zamarone already ran it by our city engineers from a drainage standpoint, and there's no impact.
Okay, thank you.
The use of the building itself, where are the activities that you plan on putting in this building currently being held?
Right now, there's an existing gym that was built with the school, was built in the 1960s. And when the school was built, it was an all-boys school. And so now that it's gone co-ed a few years back, the facilities, they really need the facilities to expand because of the sports. And also the girls have very limited lockers right now. It was a makeshift locker room for them. So for the last couple of years, they've been asking for a new facility for that. They also want to have a facility that they can use during the daytime to keep the kids out of the bad weather and the whole PE in, and also maybe whole practice in. Whether it's basketball, it's big enough that they've even talked about, you know, having the baseball team in there, just throwing baseballs during, rainy days or something like that, just to have a facility for them to be in.
Okay, so this isn't bringing new activities.
No, the basketball's already on the. They already have basketball, volleyball on the site. They already have baseball, so we're not bringing any new sports into it. But they will be using for competition, since they only have one gym out there. The new gym will be able to have competitions for, both the boys and the girls at the same time, or multiple teams play at the same time if they're having a tournament for volleyball or something like that.
Is there any net impact to traffic in the area? Has there been a traffic study or any? Is one even required in this instance?
I have not been asked to do one. The only traffic impact I could think of is if they're holding it on the weekend for a game. Okay. We're not increasing the traffic Monday through Friday during the school time because it's not going to be used for any competition during school time. It's going to be whatever students are on campus at the time. That's the number of students that are going to be there.
So, all right, thank you.
So it's giving you the ability to spread out the activities right now that are very condensed. They're being spread out, and it looks like you're giving the girls an amazing locker room space of their own, which now maybe they're in a smaller space. Having to share next door to the boys, and the boys maybe can spread out where they are, and the girls will have their own new space, and just spreading your wings a little bit across the campus then, rather than having students so condensed together. That sounds wonderful in this day and age when we're trying to get the students to stay further apart. I was excited to see such an extensive locker room for your young women that are on the campus. I was very impressed with the training facilities and everything that I saw on the plan. Good job. Kudos for those female athletes. I appreciate, as I looked at it, that it really is invisible to the city. It's just looks like a good improvement for your school overall there at Antonian without impacting the city of Castle Hills at all that I could see, other than maybe a flash of the building as you drive by, hopefully well under the speed limit on West Avenue. So yes, I enjoyed looking at this project a lot, having that I have a female athlete of my own at another school. So it looked beautiful.
I just have two questions. The first, are there any outside speakers? We're announcing anything?
No.
Okay. Second, I guess is really more towards you, Mr. Rampley. What's the ordinance for exterior of commercial buildings? He said it's metal building, and I know with residential that usually don't have metal without a percentage of brick or some other material. Any issues with that?
Mr. Zamarone can comment on the commercial side. I mean, residential state law did change a couple of years ago, but I don't think there was any changes to the commercial side of that.
Because it's a gymnasium, right?
Yeah. Louis, can you, anything you want to add to that?
I don't recall any restrictions on the commercial side of it or the use. My, Mr. Rappi had heard it was in some way, basically it says that any material that is acceptable for the ICC has to be acceptable for the municipality.
Yeah, I mean, typically they are, but I didn't know if our ordinance had anything that it excluded, but I think it's a wonderful project. I welcome y'all.
We actually had a change to conform to state law because of it.
Any other discussion? Mr. Middleman, did you have anything to say before we make a motion?
No, it looks like you've covered all your bases and this is really not for aesthetic purposes as much as it is for efficiency and functionality and probably budget purposes. And I don't think it will have any impact, shouldn't have any impact because it's not visual from any public street.
Close the discussion. Do I have any motion?
I've been vocal tonight, but I will gladly make a motion to accept the proposed construction of a new indoor activity center at Antonian Preparatory High School with all the CB 505As, et cetera, et cetera. Make a motion to approve.
I'll second.
Seconded. All in favor, say aye.
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 Impose? Passes?
Again, this application will be in front of City Council on September 14th.
Thank you.
Okay.
Move we adjourn.
Second?
Second.
Second by George. We're adjourned.